Ever since the very first anniversary of the birth of the United States on July 4th, 1777, fireworks have been used as a way to mark and celebrate this occasion. The crack, flash, and boom are connected to many holidays around the world, but at least in the US, none are more prominent than the 4th. In this video, I'll be exploring the history of the groundbreaking technology behind these displays and what it takes to produce it myself from scratch, sourcing the main three ingredients from several unique sources: an abandoned sulfur mine near Death Valley, the processed excrements from bats, and charred wood. And hopefully, I'll manage to keep all my fingers in the process. My name is Andy, and this is How to Make Everything. First, a warning. The compounds that we made and used in this video can be potentially dangerous. I've taken great care to work closely with experienced professionals in order to do this as safe as possible. The laws regarding producing your own fireworks vary from region to region, but I've made the best attempt to follow through with doing everything legally. While fireworks are deeply connected with the American holiday of Independence Day, like most things in America, most of it's actually made in China, with 85.6% of all firework exports worldwide coming from China. But this is rather fitting, as China is also the birthplace of fireworks itself. The first fireworks were believed to be made simply by burning sticks of bamboo, which in high heats would make a loud bang. This is caused by the air trapped in the bamboo that expands as it heats and eventually builds up enough pressure to burst through the bamboo fiber, causing a loud bang. This startling noise became a part of Chinese culture and was believed to be able to expel evil spirits and bring about luck and happiness. However, fireworks achieved its modern form after discovery of an even more reactive compound in the 9th century, gunpowder. Gunpowder is composed of three unique compounds: sulfur, charcoal, and potassium nitrate. Individually, these compounds are fairly non-reactive, but together, they form a very fast-burning fire. There are three parts needed for a fire: oxygen, heat, and fuel. The sulfur and charcoal act as a fuel, while the potassium nitrate provides oxygen as an oxidizer. Using sulfur has the added benefit of burning at a lower temperature, decreasing the initial amount of heat required for ignition. Similar to the heated air trapped in the bamboo, this rapid fire produces an expansion of gases and releases energy at a much higher magnitude. This technology allowed it to be contained and used as firecrackers or explosives, or directed and used as a propellant for rocketry. But now, it's time to make my own fireworks, hopefully just in time for Independence Day. The first ingredient takes me to Death Valley in California. Following a long, windy road through the mountains, I reached an abandoned mining site, Crater Sulfur Mine, containing the largest sulfur deposit west of the Mississippi. This area was home to a small mining town started in the 1920s. In 1953, a sulfur dust explosion destroyed the main mill site. It was mined off and on the following years, but today remains abandoned.
So I'm here, just the northern tip of Death Valley, and this is what used to be a sulfur mine that, you can't tell, it blew up. Which isn't surprising with sulfur. It's a bit flammable, so it's gonna be used for making fireworks. If you look at it, it's got a slight yellow hue to it. You get up close, there's these really pure chunks of sulfur in there. So I'm just gonna collect a bucket of that and take it home with me and make some fireworks. All right, got a bucket of sulfur, and it smells horrible here, like rotten eggs. I'm gonna get out of here.
With sulfur in hand, the next key ingredient is potassium nitrate. There are a few methods to source this crucial ingredient, but the one I'm gonna attempt involves bats and their droppings. I've ran into angry bats before while in an old mine in Utah.
No, you have a bat friend.
There, your buddy's coming.
But this time, I'm getting some help from Jill at the Minnesota Valley National Wildlife Refuge for some help finding some bat guano.
So what kind of bats do you find around here?
So we have 7 different species that are found in Minnesota. 4 cave bat species and 3 tree bats. So this is a 4-chambered house. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of, it actually could house up to maybe 150, 200 bats. It's pretty amazing. There are 4 different slots there, and the bats kind of just, they kind of cram in there, and this would be for a maternity colony, several females and their young. So our cave bats are the ones that actually, they tough it out and they hang out here over the winter months and hibernate in our caves and mines. Our migratory tree bats, they're the ones that actually leave for the winter, similar to our migratory birds. So actually all of our bat species do roost in trees over the summer months.
So right now they'd probably be in one of these roosts?
They would be, yep. A lot of trees that we have here that'd be suitable for roosts. And a lot of times what they're keying into are areas on the trees where there's a little bit of decay that's happening, mm-hmm. and maybe some peeling bark, areas where there's cracks or crevices that have formed. Earlier in the summer, usually these maternity roosts, so these females and their young, there's usually a lot more of them kind of congregating together. Mm-hmm. And as the summer goes on and the young kind of start growing up or getting older and are able to fly, mm-hmm. then they start dispersing. And so the roost size really kind of decreases over the course of the summer.
Can you help me find some of the roosts around here?
Yeah, so some of these trees here, you can see some peeling bark, that type of thing. And that's usually where these bats, the maternity colonies at least, will be found. So when you're walking in the woods and you see, you know, maybe a dead tree, a snag, with some bark peeling off, you know, that could be a bat roost. And we encourage if people have those types of trees on their property, if it's not a safety hazard, to just leave them, because actually they're really great bat habitat.
So what I'm interested in is their actual droppings. Where do you normally find that? Is it like under the roosts?
They go whenever. So they go, you know, sometimes when they're flying, but then also when they are roosting. And so it's kind of interesting because, again, bats, you know, they hang upside down, but they can actually change their position when they're roosting.
So what's so special about the bat guano?
Bat guano is very high in nitrogen, which is a great fertilizer. So our bats around here, they're insectivores, and so they eat actually a ton of these pests. They save farmers billions of dollars every year. Also at the festival, we have a bat guano activity where folks can actually look through a high-powered microscope and figure out exactly what that bat was eating. And sometimes you'll see just those different parts of the insects, so you won't see them whole.
The Wildlife Refuge has an annual event in July covering local bats. So if you want to learn more and live nearby, I recommend checking it out. But as for my guano, unfortunately, I wasn't able to locate any guano deposits, and they weren't super comfortable with me stealing stuff from the reserve, so I left empty-handed. Well, for Chris happens to know someone who's collected leftover guano from bats that used to live in their attic, and he was able to hook us up with a bucket of guano. The potassium nitrate is water-soluble, so extracting it is a matter of soaking the guano for a day, then straining out the solids. Do I ever? Then, straining it once more with a finer coffee filter. Wait, this isn't the right footage. And then laying it out to slowly evaporate, and the potassium nitrate should hopefully crystallize out of the solution. The hot, humid summers of Minnesota can make this a bit of a pain, so I set up a desiccant to help assist in sucking out the moisture. Letting the solution evaporate, the potassium nitrate should start to form as small white crystals on the surface. Scraping off the tiny crystals, I can resaturate and repeat to slowly get a more concentrated solution. Lastly, it can be recrystallized to form a fairly pure final result. The last compound needed for the propellant is charcoal. Charcoal acts as a fuel for the fire and is made by burning wood in a low oxygen environment, which burns off nearly everything but pure carbon. To make my charcoal, I'm going to use a simple method of just a paint can with a few vents punched into it. First, I need to burn off the lining, then fill it with a softwood, stick it on the fire, and bake it. Any oxygen in the can will be used up right away, allowing the impurities to heat up, vaporize, and escape out the vents. Once the gas stops escaping, it should be complete and just needs to be sealed and left to cool. Come back the next day, and inside should be my new batch of charcoal. I now have the three main ingredients for the propellant completed. But there are still two more ingredients I'll need. Binding agent called Dextran, and the body of the firework itself. For the body, I'm going to take a note from its historical Chinese roots and use bamboo. I'm here at their cuttings pile where they have all their scraps to be able to select a few decent pieces, try and somehow fit into my carry-on. And in the process, I've made a bloody mess of my hand. So I'm gonna pack this up, bandage myself up before I bleed to death. The binding agent Dextran is made from corn flour. Previously, I collected some corn at a corn maze in my attempt to make my own candy corn. I still have a bit left over, so I just need to grind that into flour, strain it, and then bake it in the oven at 400 degrees Fahrenheit. This breaks down the cornstarch and produces the binding compound, dextran. Corn is something that can be used in a lot of different things, so before I use up all my corn, I actually planted some of it and have a whole new crop of it coming in, amongst a bunch of other plants for future episodes. Now, with all the needed ingredients, I just need to put together my fireworks. This is when things can become hazardous, and depending on where you live, potentially illegal. So that portion will be a separate, non-monetized video. If you are interested in producing your own fireworks, there are many clubs and organizations you can connect with who can help you pursue this hobby in a safe manner. Pyrotechnics always has an inherent risk, and caution is advised, even when using store-bought. Now with them built, the moment of truth. Time to set them off and see how well this attempt worked. I tried making my own firecracker with some of my leftover paper, but that didn't work super great. But I also made a couple fireworks called mines. And overall, my fuses were a little unpredictable. I'm not really sure if that was how it's supposed to go, but I'm reasonably satisfied. Overall, the end result is both amazing, considering the journey to produce everything and harness this powerful chemical reaction, but also a bit disappointing compared to the countless professionally produced fireworks I've seen in my lifetime. Also, the fact that a bunch of kids came in and started launching their more impressive store-bought fireworks right next to us definitely didn't help. Overall though, I think I managed to recreate something that is at least somewhat similar to how the fireworks were first made. I made some simpler fireworks for this first attempt, but later this summer, I'm hoping to connect with some experts, take things to the next level, and start getting into rocketry. This video was a big risk for us, as it has a decent chance of getting demonetized, resulting in a bunch of wasted time and money we won't get back. If you want us to see more videos like this, consider supporting us on Patreon, so that we aren't limited to only what YouTube considers ad-friendly. Thanks for your support, and thanks for watching.